bikes, mate, having that step still that I got, so much easier.
Getting up on the
road. Yeah. No, can we get the mechanic down here? We've got three crushers down the end not working. Got two here not working.
So what's your way? And just stopping you over near the door there for me. The ground is a little bit wet, so we're just taking it off. Yeah, this
one. First steps into the mine.
Moving forward a
bit more. This is good temperature.
Love it.
Yeah.
Now what I'm going to do is hold this door for you. Now there is a puddle. Please don't try to jump it. We're just walking that wall.
That's pretty cool.
It'll be short of mine to the front floor and behind them. And we all see the teddy bears on the way.
Yes.
Yeah, they're our lucky charms. A lot of miners believe little people lived underground, what we call leprechauns or pesties, and most mines will have lucky charms in them. Now we're on level two, we're 61 metres underground. And 61 metres is a 20-storey building or three of our pocket head. Our mine, 410 metres deep, we don't go that far. Nowadays we're flooded from level 10. They're 250 metres underground. Average depth of Bendigo mines is 800 metres and our deepest 1406. And that's at Victoria Hill. Not far from here, just down the road from the basketball stadium, over the hill from the Gold Mines Hotel. Most mines had a pub nearby. The National on the corner over here, okay? So if you're working the bottom level at Victoria Hill, it would be around 50 degrees and 90% humidity. Yeah. This level will always be 14 degrees. The deeper you're going, the hotter it'll get. So the bottom level of this mine, it would be around 35 degrees and probably about 80% humidity, okay? We're down our main shaft here, and this is where our cages are going. So as one cage is coming down with miners or equipment in it, the other cage will be heading back up. The red button here, that is the knocker line. And that's how the miners talk to the miner driver. You're not down here yelling out, hoist the cage or take us to level 8. They're not going to hear you on the surface. So it's all about ringing bells. Now the miners memorise their signals, but there's always a chart on the wall at every level. So today, if we go in little cages going to level 2, it's one bell, slight pause, two bells. The winder driver repeats that signal and would lower us 61 metres in 15 seconds. The big cage we rode in takes 82 seconds. Over here, we have our water pipe. And water is the biggest issue for mines. Millions of years ago, this is the ocean. So you have your rising water table. When it rains, water seeping underground. So the old days, they'd use their bailing tank, hold 1,100 litres of water. And they'd aim to fill anywhere between 90 to 100 tanks of a night time, okay? And those tanks, as they got to the top, little lever on the top right would hit a block of wood on the side of the shaft, the little trap door would open, and the water would flow into the gully trap and then out into the creek behind us. Nowadays, we use electric pumps, and we pump out 2 million litres of water a day out of this mine. If we don't do that, the water's rising a couple of feet a day, all of a sudden we can't run to us. And we do recycle that water, and it's used on gardens and sporting events, even farming, okay? Over the other side, our ladder way. Now, if the winder broke down, the only way out is climbing ladders. We won't have to do that today. From here, we take the miners about 10 to 15 minutes. If they're on level 17, it'll take 2.5 hours to get to the top.
Wow.
The water dripping down plays a really important part. These timbers are Murray River red gum. And they've been here since the mine was built in 1939, 83 years ago. Keep these wet, they hold their shape. The last thing we want, these timbers dry out and crack and your shaft go tumbling down. So the water we pump out each day, turn a little hose on, and the water will trickle down at different times of the day. The water on the floor is rainwater. And that's not rain from earlier in the week, that's from at least 6 months ago. That's how long it takes to work its way through the rock. This little area that we're on is known as the Flatfield Platform. Now it's a Cornish mining term. The best hard rock miners in the world are from Cornwall in England. When I started the heading out here, and as time went on, the mining companies would recruit them. And Cornish miners were not very tall. They were an average height of 5'5" or 162 centimetres. Pound for pound, they are the strongest workers in the world. And how do they get so strong? Because of the pushing ore trucks around. Now let's imagine the 1940s and you're working at this mine, okay? Young bloke here, looks like you've been out in the sun a fair bit, but you're on tomorrow's shift, okay? Have to be 14 and a half to be a miner in the old days. The miners will always work in pairs. So tomorrow, this young fella and the bloke next to you, you two will work together. And you will fill anywhere between 32 and 60 ore trucks. And that's not the only thing you do for the day. You do that for 3 or 4 hours, you have a rest, you do drilling for a couple of hours, you have another rest, you do your blast. Back the next day, start filling the trucks again. And it was all done by hand. The rock was around Aussie football or soccer ball size, so you're either picking the rock up and throwing it into the truck, or you're shoveling. Give you guys a couple of weeks mining, you'll have arms as big as 4. You don't go to the gym, you just go to work, okay? Now it's great we've got so many girls and women in our group today, but if it's the 1940s, you're not allowed to work in a mine. That's not fair, is it? It's not that the women couldn't do the work, they were viewed as bad luck. That's all changed now. A lot of women work in the mines and they will do exactly the same jobs as the men, and in many cases, even better. And never tell a girl or a woman they cannot do something. They'll do it and then some. It wasn't Mum who told me that, it was my dad. Dad was spot on. Best advice I got from my mum was my first day at school, almost 50 years ago. But it was a very simple message. Have a go. Whatever you're doing, school, work, sport, whatever it is, have a go and do your best. And I've done that every day. I think most of us do, right? Some days are tougher than others, but if you go in with a willingness to try, you will be okay. And the other one, Ken will do. I can do this. I will do this. We'll find out tomorrow. You guys might think, no, mine's not for me. That's okay. But you have a go at it, and you decide what you want to do. Some of the young girl over here, she wants to, yeah, I wouldn't want to be the miner. Their decision. She decides, yep, this is what I would like to do, and she'll do her very best to be a miner. All understanding of what they have? Well, yeah, now head down here to our crib. Come on down this way. Grab a seat on the benches, and we'll just watch the table as you go, won't you?
Stuff on your head. Most photographs exhibit where it has golden clocks.
Yes, that would have to be. It would have to be, wouldn't it? Yeah. No.
This is pretty cool. The Bendigo buck. Yeah.
Oh, look at that.
Wow.
Oh, wow.
That's huge.
That's pretty cool.
We sort of limit how many we'll have underground at any one time. There's too many down here, obviously we're all drawing on the oxygen. So we're always thinking where and where. We never have 300 people underground at once.
Yeah.
Doing tours. Maybe be able to leave the people down underground for whatever reason, that would be different. But that's where you'd have the buildings going to circulate and work through the mine. Any idea what this is? Well done, but it's got a special name. Thunderbox. That's what you're going to say, the Thunderbox? Yeah. But they're using them, occasionally sound like thunder going through the mine. So Ken, end of shift, the youngest miner in the party or the newest miner, their job to carry the can. Right, they're carried all the way from here down to the cages to put it in. You have an old truck coming back from here that you'll have rock in, put the can on top, and then away we go. And you weren't in an open area like this. It would have been behind here, hitching on a blanket. When the corner's up, okay to use, corner down, it's being used. Now, have you heard the saying, I've got your back? I've got your back to all to do with what's above us. When you're working, you're occasionally glancing to make sure there's not small pieces of rock falling. If they are, the area's unsafe and you've got to put your supports in. Early years was timber, now it's meshing and bolting, okay? So I've got your back, looking out for one another. So at the moment, we've got the young miners over here. I look above them to make sure everything's okay. They do exactly the same thing for me over here. Looking above you, you look above me. Some people think I've got your back means you've got to be standing behind them. It's not. It's wherever you're standing is looking out for one another. The miners are really well paid for their work, but there's two things they value above everything else. They both start with F. Any idea what they are? A lot of you are with them today, I'm
family.
Yeah, family and?
Friend.
Spot on. Group the other day said food and footy. I hope you were top 10, wouldn't they? But it's family and friends. Family's the most important thing we have when it's all said and done. And friendship, you can't buy that. And for the miners, it was that mateship they developed was incredibly important to them. And that's with any work. You know, no matter what you do, the people you work with, you get along with one another as best you can. Not always going to happen, but you'll do the best you can to do that. We're going to change direction here. We've been heading westerly, right? We're going to change direction. A bit further along, I'll explain about reading of the rock, letting you know what direction you're going, but also your best chances of finding gold. As we go down here, there's a bit of a puddle on the left-hand side. Just be wary of that one, okay? Come on through this way. Okay. Now this is our newer way of doing supports. It's meshing and bolting. We started in America in the 1970s, Australia in the 1980s. And I'm about putting supports in, you sound the back. Grab a drill bit and hit it. If we get a ringing sound, it's hollow rock. If we get a ringing sound, it's solid rock. I'll get it right. Solid rock, we don't have to do anything. If it's a drumming sound, it's hollow rock. And that's where we have to remove that rock or put our supports in. These bolts that go in are 6 feet long and they're made of spring steel. You all see the split? You can press on these all day, they will not close over. It's always pressing out against the rock. And the miners, using their drills, they'll put these into the wall. We're not going in a straight line. A lot of pressure in the rock, all you would do is bend a bolt, not going to hold the rock that way. So they go in on an angle and press outwards. And these bolts hold up to 5 tonne of rock. Much easier to put in than timber, means we're not chopping down lots of trees. The idea of this goes way back to the ancient Romans, arguably the greatest builders in history. I reckon the Chinese and the Egyptians could have a good argument, don't they? Notice here we have an arch. Not a perfect arch, but being an arch gives you more strength than if it's just straight across. The Sydney Harbour Bridge is a classic example of sharing pressure. The Chinese miners, there were hundreds of them in Bendigo, they believe evil spirits can hide in corners. So their drives were done incredibly well, and their shafts were circular. Give good for evil spirits to get in their mine and to stay there. So not only an engineering idea that works, a belief they've held for thousands of years. All right. Well, understanding all that, okay? Yep. This idea now used a lot in building or even roadworks. You'll see a lot of the roadworks now with the big hills beside them. They'll have these massive bolts going into them and cables just to hold the earth in place. So if you go along the Great Ocean Road, passengers can look at the hills. Drivers keep it on the road, won't you? Yep. Come down this way. This area here, the mine, is nicknamed Sherwood Forest. Bendigo is named after a boxer from Nottingham in England. In Nottingham, the home of Sherwood Forest and Robin Hood and all the crew. The timber they've used here is greybox. It's one of the strongest timbers in the world. It'll swell in the moist air and press against the back. So it also becomes a warning system for the miners. If there's a lot of movement in the rock, the timbers are creaking. If they're creaking, do not run. Walk as fast as you can. Let other miners know and strengthen those supports. We've never heard these timbers creaking, okay? And they didn't use nails or bolts back in the 1930s and so on. Nails cost a lot of money and they'd rust in the moist air. What you would do is cut slots into the timber. These are known as split sets. It's a bit like Lego, really. Cutting a slot into the leg, a slot into the cap, and that locks into place perfectly. The only problem we had during the gold rush, chopping down all the trees. The bushland up at the top and the forest underneath the city. When we talk of under the city, is more than 5,000 kilometres of mining tunnels. So there's more streets under Bendigo than there is on the surface. And if we have a look at our timbers, they look a lot like trenches. So in wartime, especially World War I, a lot of miners heading to the war, and they're teaching other soldiers about building supports. They're that good at what they did. A lot of your trenches are Gallipoli. Across Belgium and France are still standing 107 years later. So when you're doing this, no shortcuts. It's not only your safety, the safety of all your workmates. Some people would say miners are obsessive compulsive. They check it, and they check it again. But I call it being safe. So we're going to head on down here so we can find what we're looking for. What are we looking for again?
Dogs.
Well done. Yep, well done. He knows what he's doing. If you look at the wall on our left-hand side, okay, it'll be shorter miners to the front and then taller in behind them, okay? Come on down this way. So this is Fool's Gold. It shines more because of the minerals that are in it and its shape. It's shaped like glass. It reflects light a lot more than what gold would be. It has a small amount of gold in it, but was mainly mined for sulfur. Why it became known as Fool's Gold? Early years, people were told, go underground and find the shiny stuff. And that's the shiny stuff. So they'd mine it out and take it to the bank. Now gold is 19 times heavier than water, okay? This doesn't weigh much, so they'd weigh it at the bank and they'd say, no, that's not gold, that's fool's gold. You're a fool. If you have a mining, right, and you want to check whether it's gold or fool's gold, one is checking the colour, okay, but the other one is the weight. Get a glass of water and put what you found in the water. Gold will go to the bottom straight away. Fool's gold will sink down much slower, okay? Oh, there we go. But if you found this, there's a chance there's gold. And there is gold around here, that's over in the other one. What we need to do is new miners work up in front of the window, and then all the miners in behind them. We've got our three rocks, and our gold's in the white. My God, we're on the rock there already. It's up the top there, looks like five or six of the yellow stones. That's gold. And that little group there, that's around about $3,500 worth. At the second window, the quartz down the bottom, there's another four colours there, and that's around $2,500, okay? Nuggets of gold you'll only find on the surface. Underground, it's these tiny little colours trapped in the rock. It cools and hardens, and of course the gold stays there. Now, Central Deborah, they were mining here 1939 to 54. In that time, they mined out 929 kilograms of gold. In today's market, that is around $70 million. To get that amount of gold, they took out 64,000 tonne of quartz and 40,000 tonne of mica. Wendigo's gold rush went from 1851 to 1954. And in that time, there were more than 5,500 mines sunk on a field that was 15 kilometres north-south and 5 kilometres east-west. And they mined out 720,000 kilograms of gold. In today's market, that is $58 billion. For its size, Bendigo is the richest gold field in the world. We have more deep mines here than any gold field in the world, and we are the richest gold field in Australia. As a title we held up to late 1960s, then Kalgoorlie and WA went past us. We're back at number one. Now, there's no active mining happening in Bendigo. The nearest gold mine we have is Fosterman, 30 minutes from here between Heathcote and Oakstar. They are mining out $1 million worth of gold a week and employ more than 800 people. And they are considered part of Greater Bendigo. So, key figures are added on to us. Kalgoorlie aren't too happy about it, but we didn't make the rules. Okay. A lot of you have probably been to Ballarat, over to Sovereign Hill and so on.
Yeah.
Great little spot, isn't it? They market themselves very well at Sovereign Hill. They like to say they're the gold capital of Australia. But I'll give you two figures, okay? 720,000, 200,000. So we're a bit ahead of Ballarat, aren't we? We like Ballarat. We're friendly rivals. At Ballarat, there was gold discovered at Ballarat before Bendigo, a few months earlier. Gold was first discovered in Australia at Bathurst. So not only are they famous for the panorama and the carvings, that's where gold was first discovered. Okay. There's still a lot of gold on the Bendigo field, but to mine it now would be costing a lot of money. The roads you're building are much, much bigger than what we have here. For the ore trucks and their equipment and so on, your wages build. The best paid miners now are well over $200,000 a year. And even your lowest paid workers are probably on anywhere between $60,000 to $70,000 a year. They work incredibly hard for that sort of money. I had a guy the other week say, gee, they get paid well. And I said, yeah, they do. Go and be a miner for that. Okay? It's incredibly hard work.
12-hour shifts.
12-hour shifts, you're on your feet a lot, and you're having to concentrate a lot. You're not doing 12 hours non-stop work, but you're underground those 12 hours, unless you have to be brought out for a reason, but you're underground. The old days here, it was 8 hours underground, and you're spending your time down here. It's not like our meal time comes around, we'll go to the top, we can all be on the one shift, we can only fit four in a cage at a time. So imagine if you're amongst the last to get to the top. Back to work straight away, usually. And the other one was security. If you're only going out of the mine once, only one chance of smuggling any quartz out. It might have gold in it. But end of shift, straight out of the cage, into the change rooms, file in pairs, take off your clothing and boots, into the rag picker. He'll check if there's any quartz in there trying to hide your clothes. And while you're showering, he keeps an eye on you. There's no doors or curtains in the shower cubicles. You might have hidden that quartz in your hair, in your beard, you might put the rock in your mouth. If you're not going to swallow the rock, it's like glass, but you may try to hide it. And if you were caught stealing, you would lose your job straight away and never work on the gold fields again. Not just Bendigo, anywhere in Australia, they would find out what had happened. So all understanding all that, okay? Mm-hmm. 1954, two main reasons. One, was the gold price was at 34, it was early 60s, but 1954, the biggest issue they had was the water. Okay, in 1954, there were only two or three mines still operating in Bendigo, and they were spending more time and money bailing out the water than they were getting the gold. So we're finding enough gold to pay the workers, but there was no money for equipment, and there was no money for the investors or the shareholders. And as mines, you're relying a lot on your investors, particularly if you wanted to go deeper, have that capital behind you to go and to be able to do those works. And the other one was the gold price, being $35 an ounce. So it just wasn't viable as such. So we had mining start again in the early 90s as such, but then the global financial crisis hit, and that sent the gold price plummeting again. The gold is making a real revival, not just in Victoria, but across Australia. There's quite a lot of what's happening at the moment, and they're arguing it incredibly well. Doesn't mean the boom will last forever. They're doing okay. We're going to head on there. And what we'll do is, you guys just make your way, sit on my right, please, just stop in there for me. The people on the back can stop, have a look at this window and get a photo of the gold if they need to. There's something there. The yellow in the wall there, that's sulfur. There's something there for me. I suppose we'll just turn it back. You might want to get a photo of the gold on up there. There we go. Yeah, that looks like gold, but that's sulfur. So, if you haven't touched it, that's okay. Just make sure you wash your hands up before you wash that. Go on the tour. Don't have it. Really, the only things we have in our mind are obviously the gold, the fluid gold, the sulfur, and quartz. This one here, the strawberries, the kids they see all that yellow. Oh, look at all that.
Do you reckon it goes deep for that one?
Nice. Oh, yes. There's a ladder there.
Layers upon layer of the land, and that's going back 500 million years ago. This sedimentary rock, extreme forces east and west compact the sand, buckling it 100 million years ago. More extreme forces breaking the rock apart, lava flowing into there. That lava has our gold in it, into the rocks, end up with their veins or ribbons of quartz. Yeah, that one there, that was from a demo over the years. So, and here, this part, the TAFE cottage, they did have a mining course happening, and they used to come down and do a little bit of drilling practice and so on. So they would have been working on different patterns here they were doing. So, and again, where you see letters and so on, they're letting us know what drives were in. The old days, the drives were usually named after a miner. This drive we're on here, this is Snowy's drive. Also called Snowy, the man who worked on here, his nickname was Snowy. He had jet black hair, so that's how that all came about. But now, to make it easier, particularly when we have contractors coming in, they may have never been in our mine before, so we don't say, I'll go to Snowy's drive, they're thinking, where's that? We'll say, well, it's C drive or F drive or whatever it may be. So that's what we have, our drives, different directions, A, B, C. I prefer to keep the names, but now it's the letters and numbers and so on. Come on, Andy, to our drills. Come on through.
What's down here?
Small
fair way. That'd be a fossil.
Yeah.
Wow. The drill bit. Sorry, I've just got a question. I've got a question. That really smooth section of rock back there, is that like an old fossil or something?
No fossil. No, that's just the slate as it is.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, right. So some parts it's incredibly smooth.
Yeah.
Yeah, even on here, this fault, it's quite smooth in parts. So sometimes when they've done a blast and a cut, it'll come away really smooth.
Yeah.
Sometimes where you see it looks like the brown muck on the rock, that is calcium buildup. So some people go, I've got a crack in the rock and we put putty on there or something, but no, it's calcium. So this is our drills display. The idea of drilling was getting a 5-foot hole in the rock to put our jelly night sticks in, okay? Now back in the 1870s, there's no drills. Haven't been invented. It's hammer and tap. A big mallet and a chisel. So I'll show you hammer and tap. We've got our mallet, we've got our chisel, and it's a cold chisel. Being cold, it'll go into the rock much easier. Why Jimmy Barnes and the boys called cold chisel? Most of them have links to mining through their fathers and grandfathers. So you put your chisel in, give it a hit, and a turn. And I turn my chisel with each strike. If I just keep hammering away, it'll get stuck in the rock. Two miners working together takes them 3 hours to get a 5-foot hole in the rock. So tomorrow shift, you're on the hammer for the first 30 minutes, and you'll be the tap man, okay? After 30 minutes, you'll swap over. I hope you haven't hit your mate on the thumb. It's payback time. Very rarely would miners hit my mate. If they did, it was an accident. The light they were working in was not much better than this. So what you would do is use your thumb, and a little light flicking off your thumbnail. So put that over the end of the chisel. And it's 1, 2, 1, 2. You're only hitting on a 1, remember?
Right.
Notice when I was hammering away there, wasn't going real fast, was I? It's 1, 2, because my mate's got to get half time to get his thumb out of the way. And if I get there like Woody Woodpecker and go bang, 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 I won't last very long doing that. So it's just nice and steady is how they would do it, okay? By the 1880s, we had this drill, the Stroker, invented in Bendigo, and these would drill a 5-foot hole in around about 50 minutes. There was a huge problem with them. When they were drilling, the quartz and the sandstone, the dust coming off the wall is like glass. The miners, they were breathing that dust in. It would get trapped in their lungs. And they would develop what we call silicosis or miners' complaint. They'd have a lot of breathing issues, and a lot of miners were dead before they were 35. These tools became known as widow makers. A lot of miners had big families, and there were no sickness benefits. By 1915, we have this drill, the Drifter, all the way from America. And these changed mining around the world. Now we used a lot at Central Deborah and other mines around Bendigo. And these drills use water. And by using water, we kept the dust down. Holding the drill bit, water going through, washing the dirt out as we go, and our drill bits stay cool, so they're sharper for longer. And this will drill a 5-foot hole in about 10 minutes.
Yes.
I'm gonna fire this one up. When I do, I'll give you a thumbs up. So it'll be hands over ears. You'll feel the vibration through the ground. Keep an eye on my hand on the controls, okay? And if you wanted to film it, you can only run for a couple of seconds. Okay? You guys can see okay there?
I've been filming the whole time.
Turn the ear on nice and slow. Okay, are we all set? Here we go. Now the miners were drilling for up to 2 hours. It wasn't non-stop drilling. You drill a hole, reset, and away you go again. But they didn't have earmuffs in the old days. You might have packed your ears with cotton wool, rags, or even beeswax. So for a lot of miners, they had hearing issues as they went along. And the other one was their hands. the vibration through the drill. You would end up damaging the nerves in your fingers and through your hands. And your hands might end up like this. Mine isn't from drilling, mine's keyboarding as a journalist for a long time. I've damaged these fingers. They're not sore, I just want to order three drinks, I only get two and a bit. So as a miner, you might have breathing issues, hearing problems, and you may have sore hands and arms. And if you're really unlucky, it's all three. And some people ask, why would you be a miner? Mining was what they knew, and they were really skilled at it. And the illnesses didn't happen within a week or two. That is over quite a period of time. If you've come all the way from England, China, America, Germany, wherever it may be, it's not like it's too hard on going home. You haven't made the money to go back home. They tough it out. I admire all the miners. But they're panning in the creek in the 1850s, working here in the 1940s, the guys and girls at the festival. It seems to be hard work. Rewarding work, but it's hard work. Okay. My granddad was a miner, Mount Lyell, Tasmania, in Queensland in the 1930s. Pa moved here to Bendigo in the 1940s and worked at this mine. He died before I was born, but I know I've met him through my mum and my grandmother. But as a young boy, and I wouldn't have been any older than these young fellows here, I didn't really understand how hard my granddad worked. Now I have a great understanding of how tough my pa was. So he's life lesson two. Remember I said earlier about having a go? Right, lesson two, doesn't matter how old you are, is always be thankful for what your parents do for you and your grandparents. Now, many miners today, you'll all make your own mark in the world. There's no doubt about that. But your parents and your grandparents play a big part in helping you get where you are. Never forget that, will you? I haven't met Pa yet, I will one day. Just not yet. Let's go this one. A bit of a downhill run here, so I'll just take that time.
Right. Plenty of drill holes. Yeah, see? Yeah. Oh, there's an air leak. No, I know. Yeah, and candles.
Those holes with jellyknife sticks, okay? It's not dynamite or TNT, it's jellyknife. So our jellyknife, our detonator, and our fuse. And with our fuses, they're cutting them at different lengths. We want the blast going off half a second apart. If it all goes off at once, rock will break, all it does is fall on itself and stay in the wall. We want it coming away from the wall. So when you drill, where the white peg is, we're going to go in on an angle to cut a wedge into the rock. The rest we bore straight in. Four sticks per hole, using our carbide lens, we light them and work our way up the wall. And when the blast goes off, here, cutting into the rock. This row, down and away. Next row, down and away. The bottom row, they're the lifters. They're the last to go off. Take the rock from here, out to the middle of the floor. Got a 16 ton of rock come away. We go 7 foot high, 5 foot across, and 6 feet into the face. The pattern in the middle here is the learning cut. And this is all the way from Sweden. It's a newer way. Drill a hole in the middle, but we do not pack it with any jellyknife. Do the others and shoulders and necks. When this blast goes off, that's our weakest point. So that will fall to there and then away. Now the miners will light their pattern. They have enough time to walk at least 60 metres away and count the blast. This one, you want to put hands over ears, try and count them for me, okay? Our mini miners, this is part of your mining exam for tomorrow, okay? You can help them too if you like. Ready? Fire in the hole. It's 12 or 24, okay? If we had had what she said, I won't say the number, for me it's always 12 plus 1. But if we had that, some of their sticks haven't lived. Now, next crew, they will wait 30 minutes, head on in, sit through the rock, find the unexploded sticks. If they're in good enough condition, use them for another blast. If they're broken, you don't. You light a small fire, put the stick near it, and let it burn in slowly. In the old days, jelly knights take it out of pay. And you might say to your mate, broken stick, let's use them and save money. Might save money, but you might get hurt as well. But most of the time, their blasts went off, no problem at all. But when we talk of half a second, how do you measure that? That's half a second, an inch. In your thumb here, that's an inch, 2.5 centimetres, okay? So when they're doing their fuses, they're using their thumbs to measure out, okay? My uncle was a carpenter, never used a ruler in his life. Thumb, hand, forearm, feet. Why do I need a ruler when I can measure that way? So if you want one of the rulers, okay? All right, so I understand you all that, okay? As we go through here, the back's a little bit low, and a bit of water about, so we just take our time, okay?
Vein right through there. Yeah. Yeah.
That's pretty cool. Oh, it's not wrong about being low.
The drills they use nowadays are actually little controllers, the drills. Technology's made their job easier, but it's still hard work. There's no way you could do mining on this sort of way and be productive or make money out of it. If it was a little small mine, you just want to make it $100, you can do it. But if you want to make lots of money, it's a bigger scale. This here is our bogger or rocker shovel. These were invented in America in the late 1930s. They were never used on the Bendigo goldfield. They cost too much money. They were used a lot at Kalgoorlie, Broken Hill, Tasmania, and even at Castlemaine, but not in Bendigo. Bendigo is either your hands or this flash machine. You're probably all thinking that's a shovel. Is that right? It's a banjo. Shaped like a banjo, when it scrapes across the rock, seems like banjo's playing. So using these would take two miners about 10 to 15 minutes to fill a truck, 500 kilo of rock. The rocker shovel does it in a minute. Okay, so there we go. The late 1930s, these were up to $30,000. No mining video had that sort of money to buy them. And also, the miners, they were paid by how much rock they were removing. So they weren't really keen to get these in. What I mean, they would spend more time shoveling, blasting and so on, but not actually clearing them up. So they weren't really keen.
What's that blue stuff
on it? The blue, that's a bit of oil as such. Yeah, there are. Now, we were using this. It's been tagged out for a while, so you haven't been able to use it. They're like a little bobcat when they're going. This lever here, driving it backwards and forwards, the other lever, your bucket, so scooping your rock up and over. Nowadays, in the modern mines, a lot of the people driving these aren't even underground. It's all remote control. Looking for a little TV screen, no way they go. Still takes a lot of concentration. If any of you are any good with remote control cars or on a computer mouse, you might be a rocket driver.
It sounds like somebody's been Have you noticed that? Next.
Most mining jobs are really well paid. But
it could be. It sounds like footsteps, though.
There has to be more to it than that. That's what a new job. You wouldn't do money what you're doing.
Don't know.
All understanding of that, okay? We're going to make your way back. Again, the banks are being closed. There's a bit of orange water about. Now, it's not gold, it's rust. We're going fire. We can't stain in your shoes. But it does wash out. The idea is to get to the middle of the drive. And again, we just take our time. It's a little bit wet and slippery. The last thing we want to do is be falling over and hurting yourselves, okay? So I'll leave the way for you.
No problem.